Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Q, routes 11 and 15 in Howell's Wharf. Patrick Chambers in a moment on basketball. But first, we bring in the play-by-play call of the day. Jose Altuve gets the job done with his second home run.
3-2, Astros lead the Yankees last of the fifth inning. Jose Altuve leads off, Paxton delivers, and Altuve drills this one deep to left field, and you can kiss it goodbye! Off the community leader's signs, Altuve's second home run of the game, and his fourth of the series. Astros go up 4-2.
What a great player Altuve is, isn't he? Fabulous second baseman, runs the base as well, power. Jose Altuve. All right. An award in Minneapolis and some news with Penn State basketball. With that, we bring in Scott Walker, who is the chair of the Coaches versus Cancer Committee and also happens to be the general manager of the State College Spikes and the head basketball coach of the Nittany Lions, Patrick Chambers, here at the Sunbury Motors Studio. Welcome, guys.
Mr. Jones, great to see you. Scott, great to be in your company.
We're going to start out with Coaches versus Cancer, then I want to get to a list of some other items that obviously have to be talked about. Coaches versus Cancer, congratulations on being recognized at the NABC by them for what you've been able to accomplish with that. That was a recognition about everybody,
no
and
doubt.
You represented them at that. What did it mean to you that in a community this size, that they've been able to make the strides they've made in helping to somehow get rid of cancer?
Yeah, it was such an honor to be able to receive this award on behalf of Scott and the committee and all the sponsors and all the volunteers. But this great town, this great area that we live in, they're incredibly generous, and they understand how important CVC is, or fighting cancer, and helping our neighbors and helping our friends and helping our family. So it was such an honor, such a thrill to be up on that stage with some of the best coaches in America and some of the best players in America. And then for me to be able to voice that out to everybody, I think hopefully we show pride in the Penn State chapter of what we're all about.
And you've been working hard. What did it mean to you, Scott, and the committee that it was recognized not only for your hard work as a committee, but also the generosity of the people that have responded to the call?
Well, it's 24 years of effort, really, that we were recognized for. You know, we may have hit $3 million last year, but it took everybody 24 years to do it collectively. Can I take a second and just recognize all of our committee
Please.
Members real quick? There's like 20 of them, so it might
Please.
Take a second. Hey, Coach, love you.
Thank you, buddy.
Me, myself, Mike Martin, and Wendy Pelkey, they both serve as co-chairs, co-directors. And Wendy Pelkey, I got to say, if it wasn't for Wendy, I'm not so sure how much stuff would get done.
She's really organized.
She's a horse.
Yeah.
Elena Pyle, who's been around since day one, our finance chair. Andrea Wharton from HRI. Wyatt Troxel from PSECU. And my goodness, if it wasn't for PSECU the last few years, I don't think we'd be where we're quite
yeah,
at
they
today.
They really picked it up for
Boy,
us.
Do they, you know, not just are they the tournament sponsor, but they bring a lot of other resources to the table. It is pretty impressive. Eden Gilligan from the American Cancer Society. Brian Allen, BA. Tessa Antolik. Lee Asbel Swanger, Dave Baker, Cappy, our friend Cappy. Where's he at?
I'm just glad he's working.
Rose, who's in the background, but Rose does a ton of stuff for us. Thank you, Rose. Your wife, Courtney, Nick Colella, Lisa Copenhaver, Matt Craig, Steve Eske, Linda Gall, Megan Harding, Dave Krauth, Gail Miller, Ken Miller, Wendy Miller, John Pelkey, Jim Powell, Katie Prestia, Mara Ryan, Mike Schaefer, who's behind the camera.
Yeah.
How you doing, Schaefer? Love you. Tyler Smith, Phil Stout, Terry Swanger, Mike Werner, and Terry Wilcox, who's also back there. How you doing, Terry? But that's the list of folks that are on our committee that put everything together, not just the golf tournament, but all the events we do all year long.
Right. And that next major event that's coming up, that you were talking about the golf tournament, that's the primary fundraiser for the year. And it's going to be May 30th gathering, May 31st, the golf tournament. Where are you in the planning stage for that?
We are in the home stretch. I think we just hit 60 foursomes the other day. We better let Steve Eskey know. Might need to get some more golf carts. But we are
in
the home stretch.
Which is a good problem to have.
Great problem to have. And now it's just tying up all the loose ends. You know, we've done this before. It's our 23rd annual golf tournament. I think it is the premier tournament in the region.
It is.
The festivities and the gifts that we're able to provide for everyone are really, really top-notch. I've never seen anything quite like it. I play in a couple golf tournaments every now and again, so yeah, I really enjoy it. Before the golf tournament, our first time partnering on the Race Day Soiree event that's held at Blake and Linda Gall's house.
Yes.
I'm really looking forward to it.
Kentucky Derby Day.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody's
exactly.
Going to get all dressed up.
May 4th.
Maybe wear a bonnet. Or
I got to get a big hat.
Yeah, you got to get
a, is there a big hat store?
Maybe
in State
a bow tie.
College?
Yeah.
Definitely a bow tie.
Maybe you can borrow one from Girardi.
Perfect.
Yeah, Girardi probably has a big head somewhere.
No.
Probably not. You know, but think about when Bruce started this and had the committee down at the tavern one night over, I'm sure, some soft beverages. and it goes to Jerry and Ed, and the mission continued and what it is now. And Bruce comes back, Jerry comes back, love to get Ed back. But I'm sure Bruce and Jerry got to look at it when they come back and how proud they are to be one of those guys, the foundation of it, where it all started.
Right.
I mean, to be able to, again, receive that award on behalf of the Penn State chapter, they're just as big a part that we all are.
For anyone who wants to get involved, whether it happens to be a tee sponsor, hole sponsor, or wants to get a team in the tournament or an individual in the tournament, how do they do it?
The best place to go is cvcpennstate.org. It's a one-stop shop for everything that the Penn State chapter has going on, all of our upcoming events, information on sponsorship opportunities for the golf tournament, ticket information for the soiree coming up on May 4th like we just talked about. It's the best place to go. You can follow along on the top. There's drop-down menus for everything you want to find out. If you want to be a volunteer for the golf tournament too, there's some information on there as well. So cvcpennstate.org.
This also surrounds basketball. We're going to get some basketball questions here right now and talk about where you are, where you're going with this. Let's start with Lamar Stevens. This is not an unexpected thing. It is something you and I have talked about for about a year now that he probably would enter his name in. This is a look-see on his part. Where is he right now? How do you view this?
Steve, if you remember last year at this time, he didn't even...
Right, and you can do it three times.
You can do it as much as you want, and he was mature enough to say, you know what, I'm not going to do that this year. I'm not going to put my name in. But this year, it's first team all Big Ten. We had talked about it in late December during that break. Like, you're definitely putting... I'm encouraging you to put your name in and see what you do.
You told me back in July you would like to see it.
Absolutely. And same for Mike. They both have to put... I'm encouraging it. Go try to live your dream. Go give everything you got and see what happens.
And just so people know, today's the deadline to enter. Midnight tonight was the date. That's why it had to happen this week. As long as he is not in school and the calendar works out perfectly, he'll be able to do whatever workouts he needs.
Yeah.
And then there's the G League Elite, and there's the Combine in Chicago, and we'll see which one he gets invited to. But what people don't realize is when he's done, the email goes to you as to what the draft grade is, and there's five levels of grade, as including the last one, which is he not drafted, just so people know.
Yeah,
so
there's
at least,
five buckets, lottery, outside the lottery, early second, late second, and then undrafted.
Yeah. So everybody will know what the status is before the coaches versus tournament. May 29th is the last day to pull out.
Yeah. We should have information by late May on where things stand.
How valuable is just the base input from the NBA for him and Mike?
It's going to be great for them to hear what NBA execs are thinking, because it's not me who's putting him in the NBA. It's they're putting you in the NBA. The NBA people are the ones who say, yes, he can play in the NBA. I can say it all I want,
right?
His parents can say it all they want, but it's really the NBA people. So that's going to be invaluable to tell him, again, if he comes back, what he needs to work on, and if he's able to go, then, obviously he's ready.
Right. And the next part is, the new part is the involvement of the agent. It used to be an agent was, you're done. Now you can have an advisor, agent, help steer you through the press.
Correct.
And that's something that has to be that's different, and that's why it is not boom, that's it, he's done.
Right, so I think everybody got nervous because Tony hired an agent last year. Well, the rules were different last year.
Yes.
Now you can hire an agent, and he can guide you and advise you and help you get to certain locations so you can work out for NBA teams. But once you get the answer, whatever those buckets are, then you sit down, and whether it's come back, right, then the agent, that's it. That contract, that short-term contract is over, null and void, and then we come back for our senior year.
Now, let's get to the next part. KenPom started his ratings in 2002. Since 2002, Penn State has been ranked inside the top 100 seven times. Five of the last six have been your teams. Five of the last six. Only two have been in the top 50. That's the last two. 19 last year, 43 this year. Obviously, let's not gloss it over. You've got to get to the NCAA tournament. You know that. That's the goal. But what does it tell you about the climb in establishing a program that then allows you to establish a team?
Yeah, you know, I'm going to take a step back. I mean, in the last few years, we were fortunate enough to have guys good enough to go, you know, go and give this a shot as far as... That's encouraging in itself. I think you said Taylor Battle was the other
Taylor
one.
Taylor Battle's the only other one to do it.
So that's the talent that we're now getting. That's exciting. We are playing a lot of difficult, a very difficult schedule. That's what it tells you.
I may have noticed.
And it also tells you that the Big Ten is really good.
Yeah.
We're doing a great job in recruiting. The scheduling's very hard. The Big Ten's very good. I love where we're at. I've talked to Sandy Barber about this. We are building an incredible foundation for success, sustainable success. And we want that consistency. No, our record wasn't what we wanted to be, but it was not a reflection of how hard we played, how many close games we were in. It just didn't go our way. Where it went our way, the year prior when you win 26 games.
Right.
I think if we had our numbers from 2 years ago this year, we might have gotten in.
Oh, you would have, yes.
Okay, so it's like if up to the committee, and now you get a different committee. Now the committee says, okay, hey, unlucky, we would have taken you this year as opposed to...
Actually, if you flip three games, you're in.
There's no doubt. And we can talk about that all we want. We're very close. We were very young. We were 313 out of 353.
Yes.
Everybody, as right now, we got a couple guys testing the waters, but if everybody comes back... Yeah. We're in great shape.
Right. I was talking about what you've done five of the last 6 years being in the top 100, last two in the top 50. So,
do people understand that when you say that, though, Steve? Because I love the analytics. Scott, do you understand that?
No.
See, like, I love the analytics.
There's 353 teams. Penn State from 2002 to 2014 was 100 to 353, somewhere in there.
Mm-hmm. As far as RPI, as far as how hard our schedule is, as far as our wins.
Everything put together. Penn State's been in the top 100, and actually the top 87, five of the last 6 years. And the only two times have been in the top 50. Even the NCAA tournament team was not in the top 50 on analytics. It's amazing what they've done. That brings me to this. You have to work hard to establish a program, okay, which then allows you to develop teams. They can be interchangeable, but they're different. What did the establishment of a program mean to you holding a team together this year so they finished the way they did?
There's no doubt. I think what that speaks to is our culture, right? I know some people out there have talked about our culture is intact. These kids are connected. We hold them accountable. You can't do what we did in the month of January and then go 7-3 in February if you don't have great culture, resiliency, if you don't have great leadership. Because at certain points, it's not about the coach anymore, right? It's about the players. They have to take ownership, and they have to push us through. They kept showing up. You came to a ton of practice this year.
Yes.
You saw it. You witnessed it.
Film sessions.
You were in everything. They just kept showing up. I knew at some point, as hard as it was the month of January, I knew this thing was going to flip. I just didn't know when.
You kept telling them that.
But I felt it because of the way they kept showing up, the way they kept working. I knew it was going to happen eventually. And then to get a bye in the first round, come on, what you did in January, 7-3, get a bye in the Big Ten tournament?
Yeah. Right.
That's amazing. These kids are amazing.
We just talked about coaches versus cancer, which is an investment by the community. What moves a basketball program, you also need investment there as well. What has the investment meant on your part from other people and what's still to come investment-wise to make the program better, not just for the program but also for the players?
You know what, I'm going to start with season tickets first. The last 3 years, we have done a fantastic job of season tickets, student season tickets.
Yes.
Everybody's done a fabulous job with that. P.J. Mullen has done a fabulous job with that. Give him a little shout-out. And then sitting with our administration, we are now in step two of schematic designs for new locker rooms for both men and women's basketball, and a new training room, which we both share, and a new weight room, which we both share. So the investment, I hope a lot of people out there are listening to this. They are investing in basketball this offseason. They want us to succeed. They want Coach Keegs to succeed. And these are the things that we deem that is necessary. It's a need, not a dream. This is a need right now, and they understand that. And I'm excited about these steps that we're taking.
I'm going to run another stat that was a critical stat for the last 3 years.
Rose, why don't you have these stats?
You convert
what is going on here?
On your special teams 2 years ago, you converted 78%.
Yep.
Last year, the NIT season, you converted 82%.
Yep.
This year, the number was down.
Yep.
Right? Different personnel, different ways of doing it. I don't think people realize how high your conversion rate is, was the previous 2 years.
Yeah.
All right. That's what happens when you turn the TV off. This year it was down. Explain to everyone the point of emphasis, because you always see scoring opportunities, and that didn't happen as often this year.
Yeah, those 8 to 12 possessions, we talk about it, and you hear me talking about it all the time. Have to win these 8 to 10 possessions or 8 to 12 possessions because it could sway a game. It could be the difference of a game. It could be a momentum swing, and they're critical. Let's talk about the NCAA tournament right now. People don't understand. We call possession out when we're on the free throw line.
That's right.
Purdue loses. UCF loses,
right,
because of a free throw line situation, and there's many other examples out there. And then baseline out of bounds. If we can execute offensively and steal a basket, because you're typically spending most of your time on a half-court defense, then your transition defense, and your just small amounts of time on your baseline out of bounds or your sideline out of bounds. Right. So that's why we bought in over the last 3 years to let's really execute in these situations, and free throw line for that matter, to see if we can if we can win 8 out of the 12 or the 6 out of the 10. That way, bang, because you know you're going to be in a one-possession game in the Big Ten.
Right.
What were you in, Rose? 9 of them this year? One-possession game? Just in the Big Ten alone.
Just in the Big Ten alone was nine.
I'm not talking about DePaul overtime. We're not talking about Alabama being up one with 3 minutes to go.
I'm talking about last minute.
Just last minute, it's going to come down to one possession. So if we can win some more special teams, it'll put us in a better situation.
I mean, I'll give you an example. I mean, you run a great play against Ohio State. The ball rolled off the rim. I mean, it's like it happens. But it's that 78% a couple of years ago, 82% a year ago. It fell down this year. But it also shows that you've got a whole book of stuff that you know does work when executed.
No doubt. Right. And the guy's got, you know, you go back to Tony Carr, what a special talent he was.
Yeah.
What a great player he was. And the reason I think Saito Base OB is because he really made great decisions.
Made great decisions, but he also had a guy like Shep Garner, an older guard out there.
And Lamar and Mike, a healthy Mike, you're definitely right.
What does it mean for Penn State basketball to transition to being the older team?
In this league, and you and I have seen it, and we've seen it in the Final Four, teams were older. There were no one-and-dones. There were no young teams in the Final Four.
Right.
It was an older group. When Penn State, as I watched the highlights in front of me here, when Penn State is older, it finds a lot of success.
Yeah.
The last time they went to the NCAA tournament, they had 4 seniors with a young Tim Frazier.
Yeah. Right.
Right?
Exactly.
So if we can keep this group together and we can get older, you saw the analytics right now. Analytically, we're 5th in the Big Ten, top 20 in the country. Joe Lunardi already has us. Scott, buy your tickets now. Already has us as a 10th seed in the NCAA tournament. I think we're out west.
Spokane,
which is fine. I don't care. I'll go anywhere. I'll go anywhere. I'll go to France if I have to. Yeah. I'll take a boat. I'll do whatever.
Can I go?
You're definitely going. You have no choice. That's your job.
They have a lot of people.
I'm telling Scott right now, he's in. All right? He's on the charter plane. You're going. Wherever we're going, you're going. Remind me that I said this.
Oui, oui.
All right. That's what I like, the ability to adapt to the language and the people.
That's why he's the chair, all right?
So I'll just circle back to where we started. One more time on Coaches versus Cancer and what's been an award-winning year because of great effort over the years. Give us about Kentucky Derby Day and the golf tournament one more time, Scott.
Race Day Soiree. It's at Blake and Linda Gall's house. They get a big tent. I've seen the pictures. It looks amazing. All the fancy hats. Everybody gets all dressed up. There's like horse and carriage rides, for example, that take you from one place to another. It's pretty intense. I'm going.
Well, I didn't know that.
Are you going?
I'm trying. I'm trying.
You'll be there. I'll see you there. I can't wait.
That's how they took me to the last game.
Horse and buggy.
So, I can't wait for race day 4A.
When my career started, that was my mode of transportation.
That's what he means. He started so many years
so
ago.
So many years ago, they needed horse and buggy to get
Scott,
in the game.
I want to jump in, though. There's still openings for the golf tournament.
Oh, absolutely,
and
yes.
And then Thursday night's a great event.
Yep, Thursday night, May 30th, like we talked about, Coach, I'll be turning 35 that evening, so we'll have a big birthday party over at the ballpark.
Yes.
It's catered with style, literally, with Danny Rawlins.
Well, for your birthday, it should be.
Absolutely. Is Thursday night for you, or is it for... Either way, we'll figure it out.
We can debate this. You and I both know what it actually is about.
He strategically picked these dates because of his birthday.
Kidding.
That's all right. Go ahead.
Well, and some of the folks that play in the golf tournament itself, holy cow, we got some star-studded folks this year for our captains. I've met Ron Harper and heard stories about Michael Jordan that you'd never believe.
It's awesome.
It's just incredible the amount of support that we get every year. And like I said earlier, we did just hit 60 foursomes. We play fivesomes because you have a captain or a celebrity. But we can take many, many more because we play two rounds, morning and afternoon.
Right.
I was just texting with Jake Corman earlier today. There's a lot of good folks involved in the golf tournament. The 30th and the 31st, cvcpennstate.org.
And by the way, it's 65 days to the Spikes home open.
Not that anybody's counting.
I might be.
I can't wait. Hey, how about we tease a couple promotions? Because I got to get them out there.
Sure.
I'm so excited about them.
Okay.
Our good friend Trace McSorley agreed for us to be able to do a bobblehead of him this year.
Oh, nice.
I cannot wait.
I saw him yesterday.
It is going to be really, really cool. We just saw the first mold the other day. It's Trace in his home run swing.
Oh, cool.
He's got a tie in.
Nice.
His celebration. So I can't wait. We're doing our first ever Pride night on June 28th, Friday night. Fireworks. We're giving away a really, really cool Pride hat.
Great.
Spike's Pride hat. I can't wait for that one. Everybody knows David Taylor around here, right? Wrestling's so popular.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The bobblehead of David Taylor that we've put together is probably one of the coolest bobbleheads I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. He looks like Rocky Balboa. It's amazing. That dude is awesome. So I can't wait. We've got a lot of good promotions lined up for this year, and like you said about buying tickets, Coach.
Yeah, let's go.
Get your
Spike's
tickets.
Yeah. Who did I meet last year? What wrestler? Hacksaw?
Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
That was awesome.
That's right.
Yeah. Such a thrill to meet Hacksaw.
You remember the movie American Pie?
Yeah.
Of course.
You remember the Shermanator?
Yes.
Of course.
He's coming.
The Shermanator's coming.
Isn't that awesome? Really?
Nice.
Wow.
Isn't that awesome? I'm going to have to show up for that one.
Yeah. Yep.
Hey,
I will buy the tickets, though.
I will take care of it.
Okay. No. I'll buy
the you walk in the side door.
Thanks.
Hey, thanks, Steve. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
See you tomorrow night.
Yeah. Let's go banquet.
Yeah, banquet tomorrow night. Patrick Chambers, Scott Walker. Yes, the Shermanator. Now the suit might go.
Business just picked up.
The Shermanator. See the Shermanator and the suit in the same room together?
Look out.
Yeah. All right. We'll come back with more in a moment. Bottom of the hour news coming up. Jessica Marksbury, final half hour on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
I mean, when's the boss of Ward 3 going to be on from Danville? It's Ward 3 or Ward 2? Which ward's he in?
I get them mixed up all the time. But yeah, we're getting close to the May primary, so yeah.
Are you telling me he's running?
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, I could buy billboards. What's the name of the opponent? No, what? He hates that I'm quick.
And we approve this message.
A message from this station and the Ad Council. All right, today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. And let's get to the Masters leaderboard. And then we'll talk with Jessica Marksbury, who will join us from Augusta National. Pat Kazire, Joe Harding, John Rahm, Adam Scott, all at 3-under par. They all shot 69 today. Dustin Johnson, Phil Mickelson, and Ricky Fowler, J.B. Holmes, all at 2-under par. Mickelson and Johnson have just started the back nine. Tiger Woods finished at 2-under 70. So Tiger ended up with a really good opening round. And Brooks Koepka's at 1-under playing 9. Jason Day is 1-under playing 10. So there is your leaderboard. I think I mentioned Ricky Fowler shot 70. With that, we bring in from Golf.com and also Golf Magazine, the outstanding Jessica Marksbury. Jessica, welcome back. It's always great to hear you on the other end of the line.
It's lovely to be back on with you, Steve.
Well, I want to start with this before we get to the Masters. Nice job on the article in Golf Magazine, because you had written about apparel. Not the easiest thing on the face of the earth to do, but what did you learn along the way in some of the interviews and items you had to talk about that maybe even you didn't know about before?
Well, thank you. We just launched our second annual style issue. If you haven't seen it, it's on newsstands now. Michelle Wee is gracing the cover, and it's a beautiful cover, if I do say so myself. Yep. Largely because of Michelle. But what's always fun for me in looking at the latest and greatest in golf apparel is how much the apparel industry has changed. There is so much technology behind these garments now. And not only that, they're all very lifestyle inclined, I guess you could say. You know, a golfer doesn't look the way a golfer used to look. A golfer can, be wearing the appropriate apparel to go to the gym, to go to the bar after the course, to go to the range, and it's all kind of the same stuff. You know, there's hoodies and stretchy fabrics and joggers and shoes that have soles that are appropriate for both on and off the course. So it's really fun, actually, to see that lifestyle vibe kind of coming through in some of the more modern clothes. And you know what? They look great on older people and just as well as they do on young people. So, there's no generational divide there.
Yeah, that's what struck me in reading the article, because, I'm a subscriber. In reading the article was just the variety with which and the styles that they have now that, you know, you and I can wear to the course or wear to other events if we're not going to the course.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, especially, you know, the athleisure movement has been huge when it comes to golf apparel. And in women's apparel especially, you see that a lot. And, you know, the same type of Lululemon that women love to wear to the gym, you know, a lot of that is also on course appropriate. So it really, it just widens kind of the whole spectrum of brands that you might not think would be golf course appropriate. But in fact, they look great and they function well, too.
Calendars function one way, and then there's a feeling that people have another way. For example, for most people, summer begins Memorial Day weekend, even though technically it's 3 weeks later. For a lot of people, not for you, a lot of people, to them, the golf season begins this weekend because it's the Masters. How do you look at the Masters? And I always like to get a read from not just from you, but also from your family, because you have such roots in England, in Scotland.
Yeah, I mean, the Masters is huge. Obviously for us, you know, the season started in October last year. So it seems silly to think that, you know, we're so many months into the new season, but truly in my heart, the major season is where all the excitement really is. And even though we had an early Players Championship this year, I think most golf fans still feel, just as you said, this is the real beginning of the exciting portion of the PGA Tour season. And I feel like I say it every year, but I can't really remember when the hype was so huge for the Masters. You know, we have Tiger playing well. You have Rory going for the career Grand Slam. You have Phil. You know, we don't know which Phil is going to show up this week. We're still waiting to see. Yeah. But there's just so many A-listers that are playing well, and we're looking forward to seeing how they do this week. It's always a big star on the calendar. And, you know, now that I'm here, it's no different.
Yeah, because Tiger Woods in it, and I think people forget Brooks Koepka didn't play in it last year and because he had a wrist injury, and that has been forgotten by people. What is it like for you to be on the grounds again, and what memories do you have that come back to you because you are on the grounds again?
It never gets old. I'll say that much. I think, I want to say this is number 7 for me. And every time you come on site and you, for me, it's seeing that first fairway. People talk about it all the time that you don't really understand the elevation at Augusta National until you've been on site. And it's so true. The first time I set foot on the property, I think I probably audibly gasped because I just couldn't believe it. TV doesn't do it justice, and that first fairway, that first hole, is so much more difficult than you understand just watching it on TV. It's so steep, and actually, in our recent anonymous tour player poll, several of the guys told me that, you know, most people don't know this, but the first green is by far the most difficult on the whole property. So I thought that was really interesting because, you know, that's not often the hole that we think of, but it's an easy bogey for these guys. It's an easy double bogey for some of these guys, too.
What's interesting about the Masters is that it's an extremely tough course where you can easily shoot 75. Yet it's also the kind of course where suddenly you can shoot 30 or 31 in the back nine and win the tournament being 4 down. Is that do you feel like you're – I know it's changed over the years, but are there times in terms of golf course architecture that you feel like you're looking at a slice of genius from the 30s?
Oh, my gosh. You know where that was so apparent, Steve, is watching the women play in the final round on the Saturday.
Jessica,
Jennifer Kupcho.
Yes. And you know what, Jessica? I've maintained for years there should be a women's professional Masters. For years I've maintained that. At least they got the amateurs out there.
Yes. You know, I'm thinking about that, actually, for a future column, mulling it around in my head, some ways that I can approach that idea. But I love it. Watching the women compete was incredible. Jennifer's performance, especially on those final 6 holes, and then especially given what she told us about what she was going through physically with a migraine on the front nine, to come back the way she did, that is everything that you want out of a final round at any golf course, let alone Augusta National. So the fact that you can have those fireworks, those eagle opportunities on the final stretch of holes, I mean, that is what really creates the Augusta lore that we all love so much. The idea that someone can come back from way back, like Jordan Spieth almost did last year, 8 under par in the final round. That's incredible.
Right. This is the golf course where you can charge. You can charge on this course. But what struck me about the women's amateur national was this. I thought the patrons came out in droves to see it. You look at the line on the 18th fairway up to the green in the final round. That was impressive, I thought. I think that makes a statement.
Yes, no doubt about it. People want to tune into Augusta National. It's that course that we all really feel familiar with. There are so few courses that I think you could name a hole and people can picture it immediately in their mind. They can picture how to play it properly. They can picture the history that's occurred on that hole. And to see it in an entirely new perspective with these fabulous amateurs playing was a total thrill.
I'll ask one more question about this, then I'll get to the current tournament. And that involves the women professionals. You mentioned Michelle Wee, Stacey Lewis. I mean, the long list of great female players I've always felt should have the opportunity. And I also think, and I know Augusta doesn't really seem to care about its image, but image-wise, I think it would do them a world of good.
You know, I'm thinking about that, too. I know they want to protect the sanctity of this event and make it, you know, very exclusive and the idea of that, I understand. However, you know, one time, right? Make it a KPMG PGA Championship site. Make it a Women's U.S. Open site, right? It doesn't necessarily have to be a recurring event year after year, but one time, let's do it, right? What's holding us back? I'd love
nothing
to see it happen.
Right. It just needs a week.
And you know, push it to the late summer, early fall. Doesn't even necessarily have to be in the spring. It would be incredible.
One final question that's about this year's tournament. What, you know, we're all in the business of guessing before it starts. I always look, I'm going to make a prediction. Look, you're like the rest of us, you're guessing. Okay.
We're professional speculators.
We are professional speculators. And in our professional speculation, Jessica, what is your professional speculation on what could happen over the next few days?
Well, coming into this week, I was feeling very strongly that it would be a good week for Ricky Fowler. I love his game. I love his personality. I think Ricky as a green jacket winner would be huge as far as the growth of the game goes and the type of person that he is. He'd be a great champion.
Agreed.
He's a great putter. I think that's really the number one key at Augusta National. You cannot win here having a bad putting week. The other contenders that we're familiar with seeing, Justin Rose, Tiger Woods, Rory McIlroy, questionable putting at times. We've even seen that with Tiger already today, two missed five-footers. Otherwise, he'd be right there at the top of the leaderboard. That said, Tiger has the game to compete, no doubt about that. He's playing well. I fully expect to see him there on the weekend. So, I expect to see Tiger, top 10, right? At least.
Yes.
At least top 10. Will he win? I would love to say yes. Not quite sure he's all the way there, sharp enough yet, but coming in, Ricky was my pick and Tiger was my hope. We'll put it that way.
and the key for each is you can't be 63-hole players. You got to be 72. And that, I think that's the key for each one of them.
Mm-hmm.
So,
make those cuts. Make those five footers every time.
Exactly right. You've got to be able to. This is this golf course, especially with the undulation. Now, it's not as much as it used to be because I've redone some greens, but the undulation on those greens and the way you read it, you've got to be able to, on every putt, lock in. No gimmies.
No gimmies, Jessica, unfortunately.
Yeah, I know. Jessica, it is always a complete pleasure. Thank you so much for the time you gave us today. You're so generous with us, and we appreciate it.
Highlight of my day. Thank you for having me.
Jessica Marksbury, Golf Magazine, golf.com. We'll come back, wrap it up in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
We upgrade all the time.
My computer.
My TV.
My phone.
Isn't it time you upgraded your vehicle? Upgrade your trade now at Sunbury Motors Kia. I wanna see you in a Kia. Sunbury Motors Kia. It's the second annual Upgrade Your Trade event. Now is the time because SMC is making it easier than ever with above market value for your trade. Plus, save $4,500 on a 2019 Kia Sereno LX. Now just $26,415. A 2019 Kia Optima S has $4,000 in savings. Now only $22,910. And SMC is still offering a $99 a month lease on a 2019 Kia Forte LXS for just 36 months. And all include Kia's 10-year, 100,000-mile powertrain warranty. It's the second annual Upgrade Your Trade event at Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
Leases for 36 months, 10,000 miles per year. No security deposit required. Tax and tags extra. Offers expire 4/30/19. Warranty is a limited powertrain warranty. For details, see retailer or go to Kia.com.
For nearly 100 years, Purdy Insurance has been your locally owned, family-operated source for insurance products. With a staff of over 20 and partnerships with some of the industry's most trusted companies, Purdy has the experience and resources to get the job done. Whether you need personal, home, and auto, or complex business insurance solutions, Purdy will help you navigate through the process. Call today at 570-286-5855, or better yet, stop in their Sunbury office to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
The azaleas and dogwoods in bloom as we welcome you back to Augusta National, home of the Masters, where the patrons walk across the hallowed ground. They've enjoyed an opening round where Adam Scott fired a 3-under par 69. John Rahm, the Spaniard, a 3-under par 69. Joe Harding, also at 3-under par. Tiger Woods came in at 270, just one stroke back, in a group with J.B. Holmes and Ricky Fowler, all at 2-under par 70. Dustin Johnson's on the course playing 11. He's at 2-under par. Phil Mickelson, off a bogey at 10, is at 1-under par, now playing 11. But he still has the two par fives in front of him at 13 and 15. It's the opening round of a tradition unlike any other, the Masters. Not on CBS, but on WKOK.
Well, they'd never play this at the NCAA Wrestling Championships. The two docile guys walk out there. Okay, here we go.
Music's a little more aggressive.
Basketball, you start to run out and they play this, and they're just like, stop. And like, I think I'll just walk the rest of the way to the court. Football in the tunnel, let's charge out. Then they play this. Maybe I'll just walk. I'll saunter out.
Saunter. Sauntering over the Masters menu board, pimento cheese sandwiches, grilled chicken wraps.
Well, that's the one thing, that the prices at the concession stands are great.
Phenomenal. A cup of coffee for under $2 for breakfast?
They have power because they do one-year contracts with CBS. They've had 60 consecutive one-year contracts at CBS. 60 consecutive. And it gives Augusta National power over the broadcast. They limit the minutes of commercial time. I want to say 3-4 minutes, an hour, that's it.
Yeah, they've only stuck with, what, maybe 3 primary sponsors for several years?
Yeah, I want to say AT&T, Travelers, and is it Buick? I'm trying to think which car company. But they've stuck with 3 over the years. And they keep the minutes in an hour to a minimum of commercial time. You do not call the gallery anything but patrons. You know, when you have that kind of power, you know, it's a one-year contract. They can tell you bye-bye next year, and it's such a popular event for people to watch that you can put in subtle rules such as that, which end up being not so subtle.
So what's your what's your favorite hole?
Favorite hole at Augusta?
Mm-hmm.
15. Because on 15, if you stick the second shot, you got a chance at an eagle. But the ability to stick the second shot is very, very difficult. You can go into the swale in the back. It can roll to the water. There's such risk-reward on 15. That's what I like about it. You can eagle it or you can bogey it. Then you follow it up with 16. That's just a great 1-2 combination right there. We were talking to this suit the other day. I said, what's your favorite hole at Augusta National? He said the 19th. I didn't quite get it.
Your station for news, weather, business, and CBS Sports Radio. News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury and on WKOK.com.